education system in Canada, in all nine of the 10 provinces, the English-speaking provinces, is based on the Scottish system. And it partially explains why we have one of the best education systems in the world. So I'm very happy to be here. I'm going to go back in history a bit. I'd like to ask this question before I do, though. What's the purpose of copyright? Anyone want to volunteer? What do you think the purpose of copyright is? My goodness, a very shy Scottish audience.
To provide the author with control over the use of their materials.
Financial?
Yeah, I mean, these are the typical answers we get, and it's the reason why I'm starting off now to talk about copyright and what the purpose of copyright is, because educators don't really know. The publishers have been pushing for many years now the idea that copyright is about the rights of the author and the publishers and finances. And I'd like to just go into the history of it a bit. Before I do, all of my slides are under an open license. You can use and reuse them however you want. However, some images are under fair dealing in Scotland or in Canada, fair use in the United States. So, and I'll explain fair dealing a bit too today. In the 1960s, the world came up with an agreement on the World Intellectual Property Organization. And it was really the first time anyone ever used the word property to talk about ideas, intellectual productivity. It came about in 1963. Prior to that date, in the British common law countries, nothing was copyrighted, unless you put a copyright notice on the work. Otherwise, it was public domain. But in 1963, with the World Intellectual Property Organization, as it was being formed, the British common law countries, including the United States, the Commonwealth, pretty well all the countries in the Commonwealth, agreed that everything would be copyrighted. And that whatever you write, so you write an email, it's copyrighted. If somebody takes your email and forwards it to somebody else without your permission, they've broken copyright. How many have done that? How many do it every day? That's what happened, is we basically agreed with the European view, and the European view of copyright is quite different. What happened in the 1960s is the owners, the big publishers, they co-opted the rhetoric of property and started to use the term property for intellectual policy. These are quasi-copyright laws, or a form of industrial pollution. They enrich big business at the expense of common people, and they're defended as economic necessities. So that we really, to have the economy going, we must have copyright. But it is patently untrue. There are many industries that have no copyright protection. And these are some examples here. Monuments, car bodies, furniture, clothes design, recipes, perfume. They all exist with no copyright protection whatsoever. So the idea that copyright is needed for industrial development, etc., is really unprovable and unworkable. In fact, copyright can hinder development. And a major example of that is when the Wright brothers, they put up the first plane and they patented it. And in fact, they weren't the first flight. The first flight was by Alexander Graham Bell, a Scotsman, in Canada and Cape Breton. But what happened was the Americans redefined the length of a flight. from 200 yards to 400 yards, and so ours wasn't the first. Anyway, that's an aside that I thought might be of some interest. But what happened was, when they patented the airplane features, they had the patent for 17 years. Almost no developments of aircraft happened in the United States for 17 years. The lead was taken over by France, Germany, and to some extent Britain, not as much because we recognized American patents. But France and Germany didn't. They took the lead. And they were the leaders in development of aircraft up until the expiry of the patent. And then after that, there was a big boom in the United States. Now, if we look back at the concept of copyright, we had scriptural scribes. This goes back maybe 20,000 years. They're finding now that it used to be 6,000 years ago that was writing, but now they're finding there's certain writings going back even further. But in any case, the concept of copyright was utterly foreign to the ancient mind. In fact, copyists were among the most respected people in our societies. Copying was the normal way of transmitting information, and there was the concept of copyright did not exist. The first copyright case came with St. Columba in the 6th century, where he copied St. Finian's psalm book, and the king, Dermot, said, "To every cow its calf, to every book its copy," and he said it was illegal for you to have copied this psalm book. And they got into an altercation, and in County Sligo in Ireland, 3,000 people were killed in a battle over it. And St. Columba was exiled to Iona in Scotland. And that's how he ended up in Scotland. So it's a relevant history. And after that, nobody cared about copyright at all until after the invention of the printing press. The printers owned everything. And the first copyright law that all British Commonwealth and American copyright law is based on the statute of Queen Anne. Look at the title. An act for the encouragement of learning. It's not an act to protect the rights of authors. It's not an act to make sure publishers get their money. It's an act for one purpose, the encouragement of learning. And that's why it was brought in. It was brought in, and the idea was, if we give protection, a monopoly, to the author for a short period of time, so as they can make some money on it, that this will encourage learning. And what it did was it didn't bring in rights of the author, it actually limited the rights of authors. Before that, the authors, and actually it was more the printers, had unlimited rights. And this limited their rights to 17 years. And you could renew it for another 13 years. And that's the origin of copyright. So when anyone tells you about, oh, this is about protecting the rights of authors, we as educators, we need to point out that that just is simply not true. It was brought in for our benefit, to educate the population. The United States copyright law is directly based on the statute of Queen Anne. There's a historical line that shows very clearly that it came from the statute of Queen Anne. And the Copyright Act in 1790, look what it is, the name. It's not an act to protect the rights of authors. It's an act to promote the progress of science and the useful arts. Again, this is for education. It's brought in to help us to educate people. President James Madison said, incentive not property or natural law, is the foundational justification for American copyright. It is a privileged monopoly. So they like to use terms like property because we all value property and it's an important for us all. Whereas none of us like monopolies. But really, when you own copyright over a work, what it is a monopoly that the state has given you over the use of that work. And it is nothing other than a privileged monopoly. And this says it all, is that hoochie woochie sweet patootie is neither intellectual nor property. So to call it intellectual property is really Orwellian, in the sense that it says the opposite of what it really is. It is not property. It is a privileged monopoly. And you get that. No one owns creative works. What you have is a monopoly over that work. So intellectual property, or is it a manifestation of government intervention in social relations? Because you get the big publishers saying, well, we want a free market. And they say, we're on the side of the free market. But here they are, they're supporting a government monopoly, a government-imposed monopoly on the population. It's similar to imposing the duties, restricting freedom, and inflicting burden on users. And we in education have always supported the idea of copyright to reward authors for a limited time for their contribution. And no one is against us. We don't find this as being especially onerous. This is a good idea. But now they've stretched it from 17 years up to 50 years in Canada and now 7 years in most countries in the world. In fact, whenever Mickey Mouse is about ready to come on the public domain, they expand the copyright laws. Now, I want to talk about we call it the Pentalogy in Canada. The Canadian Supreme Court made this decision about fair dealing, which is part of copyright law. Have you heard the term fair dealing? Is this familiar with you? Is that for education, research, and other purposes, you have the right to make use of copyrighted material. And in Canada, the copyright collectives, they attempted to change the fee, $3 per student that we paid for the privilege of copying parts of material, to $53 per student, a huge jump. And people got a bit upset about it, didn't agree with it, and they took it to court. And they were soundly, utterly, completely defeated by our Supreme Court. Our Supreme Court said this, that fair dealing must have a large and liberal interpretation. That fair dealing is not something extra, it's part of copyright law. And that if you're interpreting it, you do it in a large and liberal manner. And the biggest example for us is class copies are okay. They said with fair dealing, you can't make copies of a chapter from a book, 2 chapters from a book, maybe a copy of a painting. The Supreme Court said, yes, you can. That is fair dealing. You can do that. And it must be a large and liberal interpretation of what you of how you do this. Because what was happening is our librarians in our universities were interpreting the law very strictly. And they were worried about $500,000 fines, which never happened. But they were more strict than the publishers. And what happened with this decision is it opened the doors to people taking a large and liberal version, so you ask yourself. So now the test is, and there's a 6-point test on it. For example, you couldn't copy a whole book. But if you copy one chapter, you're pretty safe. If you copy two or three, well, you're probably safe. But if you copy more than that, it'd start to affect the business case of the publisher. You may have a problem. But the key way to understand it is this, is you ask yourself these questions. Number one, am I a reasonable person? If the answer is yes, then you ask yourself, does this seem reasonable? If the answer is yes, copy it. That's the law. You can look at the 6-point test. Now, the reason I'm telling you that here in Scotland is this is the only decision about fair dealing in the entire British Commonwealth. There is no other decision. It has not gone to court in any other decision, in any other jurisdiction. This precedent can be used anywhere. And I encourage people to look at fair dealing, is that this is a right you have anywhere in any of the British colonies, former colonies, and go with it. Use things. Another thing that the Supreme Court said, for example, is linking on the web. You can link all you want on the web. You can bring stuff in from YouTube anywhere. You can bring it in. You don't have to pay for that. And this was upsetting to the Copyright Collective because we were paying them the $3 per student to copy one or two chapters, to link and to do all these things. And that's finished, and we don't pay them anymore. And they're very upset about it, and they're lobbying again to try to get this decision overturned. But this decision was the second time that the Supreme Court reinforced their interpretation of it. So they'll be very leery about taking us to court. They're now going to politicians wanting them to change the law. So I'm going to switch now. I wanted to give you that perspective. I want to switch now to why we need open education resources. Again, same thing, these images are all open. Now, in 2012, the Paris Open Education Resource Declaration, the countries around the world promoted open education resources in order to help meet the World Millennium Goals of UNESCO, education for all. And they felt that having open education resources would be one way of facilitating this goal. It was sort of recognized that that's not all that was needed, but that OER would be part of any solution that does come up for us to educate everyone in the world. If you want a primer on open education resources, I suggest that this is a good short pamphlet from the Commonwealth of Learning. You can find it there, and it gives you the basic background of what open education resources are. But for me, and why I'm in this, and for many teachers, is that we believe that the challenge for educators in the 21st century is how to meet the needs of more than 100 million students now, they say by 2025, who are capable of post-secondary education, who will not be able to access it because it's either not there or they can't afford it. And in order to do this using traditional universities, we would have to build 4 universities per week with 30,000 students each. So we know we cannot meet their needs using traditional ways. And John Daniel, your former president, put out some reports on this basis. The question for us, how do we educate all these learners? And my suggestion is that OER are part of the solution to this problem. I don't think they will be the solution. In fact, I'm pretty sure there will be no solution to educational problems. It'll be many different solutions for many different people, for many different educational environments. There won't be any one answer. Even if you are a dye-in-the-wool constructivist or connectivist, that's not going to be the answer. Maybe part of the answer and good in some circumstances. Open educational resources defined by UNESCO, technology-enabled resources for consultation, use, and adaptation by a community of users for non-commercial purposes. And for UNESCO, it's important for non-commercial, and I'll get into that later. Now, a lot think of it just as the content, perhaps the textbooks, but they could be games, it can be videos, it can be curriculum material, it can be audio. Many different types of things can be open educational resources. It can be a learning object. And for example, you get a component, perhaps a map, and with the component, you add other components and put it together in an educational way, and it becomes a lesson. You put a number of lessons together, and it becomes a module. You put a number of modules together, and it becomes a course. And you can even put a number of courses together and make a whole program out of learning objects and out of open learning objects or open educational resources. And this is the concept of granularity. And in my experience, going back to the learning object, I came to OER through the learning object movement in the 1990s. And the reason we did was because we found out that if you're using commercial content, you're stuck. You can't work. We had a cross-Canada collaboration, and we sat for a day and a half in a room arguing about copyright. And what we found out was that if you have an agreement between two universities on copyright, there might be 10 problems. You get three universities, it's not 10 more problems. It's 10 times 2, 20 new problems. You add another one and it's 30 new problems. You add another one and it's 60 new problems. So after a while, we suddenly realized that all the money we got for our grant would go to lawyers in negotiating agreements. And we found out that the best way is to just drop it and just make it open. It's open content and we can work with it. And with open education resources then, unlike commercial content, we can mix them, we can adapt them, we can extract things, we can take stuff out that we don't need, we can localize it, but don't get silly about localization. In Canada, we get very silly about it. Canadians sort of class their material higher than American material. We're a bit snobbish about that. So if they use American material, they want to hide it and they try to localize it. But you don't have to go and say, if the text says, she was traveling to New York, you don't have to change that to she was traveling to Toronto. I mean, that's how silly we get in Canada about the whole thing. You know, biology is pretty well for all humans. I mean, there's not a great deal of difference between Canadians and Americans. We're a little less obese. but other than that, there's not that much difference biologically between them. So localization, yes, it's important. For example, sociology. Canadian sociology is really completely different from American sociology. We have a more British orientation in sociology. And so they won't take anything from them. But I think in, you know, physics, mathematics, and other things, it doesn't make any sense to get all antsy about it. And history too, for example. In American textbooks, they never mention why the White House is white. And in all the Canadian textbooks, we know because we burnt it down. They're mainly open OER. You can augment them, you can edit them, customize them, aggregate them, and reformat them. So the idea is they're yours. You as a teacher, you as a student, you can do whatever you want with them. And commercial content doesn't allow you to do that. Are there any questions or confusion about this? Or are you all pretty well familiar with OER? What it means, though, is because of this, we can assemble courses. And I believe we've got to get out of our mind the idea we have to create courses. We can now assemble them. We can take a YouTube video. We can take a lesson from some other course. We can take a game, an electronic game, an open game. We can put it all together and put a course together that way, rather than thinking we have to create everything from scratch. We can assemble, you know, like an IKEA set. You can put it together, and yes, it can be assembling courses, can be as difficult as putting an IKEA set together. It's not not fully simple. It's not like Lego blocks. We used to use the Lego block analogy. It's a bit more complex than that. And we can debone our courses, and that's what we're doing at Athabasca now. What we're doing is we're going through our courses and saying, this resource here, can we replace it? It's commercial and we're paying for it. Can we replace it with an open source, an open education resource? So that's what we're doing. We're switching now and deboning our courses. And we're working on textbook projects with the neighboring province, British Columbia. We now have over 130 first and some second year textbooks, open textbooks, that anyone can use. And they can be put into courses and assembled, and they can be used to replace commercial texts. In Alberta now, we have about 19 courses that are being replaced with OER, and we're putting a report out on it in December, early January, and we believe we've saved our students at least $2 to $3 million. And that'll go on every semester. And the more we get, the more savings for students. Do your students pay for their textbooks? They do, yeah. Some places they don't. Now, they say, are OER free? Well, they are free to students. They don't have to pay for them. They're free to the teacher who uses them. No unnecessary duplication, so if people don't, five people make the same lesson and rather share their work together, it reduces costs. You don't have the cost of copyright clearance. Is this a problem for you in your situation? It has been in Canada and it still is. It's finding who owns something, and going back and doing the search, it's a major cost. Well, with OER, you don't need to do that anymore. And it engages open communities. And to give an example is the Collaborative Statistics textbook out of the United States. Statistics is one American thing that is acceptable in Canada. And there's a whole community growing around that. One professor has made videos for the entire course, released them as OER. Another professor linked it to SDSS in a very ordered manner for the textbook. Another one did it with other statistical packages. And they have a community that is online and they share information. So it's a wonderful way of engaging community. Now, cost consideration of using commercial content. Well, developing and improving curriculum. And the problem with commercial text is you have to wait for them to come up with their new version. And quite often, they come up with their new version of their textbook. I don't know if you have that problem in England, but they'll come up with version 2 of the textbook, and the only thing that's changed are the page numbers. So it's the, you have to buy the new book. Ongoing programming and course design to keep it up to date, your course. Planning of contact sessions with students. You have to do that whether you have commercial content or OER. The development of learning materials, the design of effective assessment. And this is where we get to this. And from the beginning, the OER movement has had this split. And as one group thinks that OER should be in these short, small modules that you can pick and choose and assemble your course. The other group thinks you should get the whole course with the exam and everything. And the big publishers are now doing that. They're putting together a whole package. So as a teacher just takes the whole package and they don't have to do any course development at all. They just have to follow the package and the students go online and do the tests. And it saves them a huge amount of time. Many teachers prefer that. Many other teachers prefer to make their own course and to pick the modules. For me, I think there's room for both. And I think what we need more of are those full packages to compete with the commercial producers, because we have quite a few modules, and the teachers who go to the trouble of assembling courses from different modules or creating their own modules are generally going to do it that way anyway. OER are free and they're adaptable. And so whatever other costs there are, it's not the cost of the content. And to give an example, in the United States you have the commercial learning service or rent-a-book, and we have this in Canada too. Have you come across this in the UK, where you rent the book for the semester? In it, the student owns nothing. The student can share nothing. They can save nothing. They sell nothing. When the subscription ends, it all ends. They remove it from your computer. The publishers own all of the students' data that's been put on there. The notes, the highlights that students put on, it's all owned by the publisher. It's lost to the student. And the students can't even transfer their data off of the rented book onto their notes. And you can imagine the problem this would be with a student who just finished Calculus 1 and he wants to take Calculus 2 and all of his material from Calculus 1 is gone. But that's the reality of these publisher ones. And David Wiley put this together for us to show just how crazy the system is. Netflix, you get 20,000 movies for $8 a month. Hulu Plus, 45,000 TV shows, $8 a month. Spotify, 15 million songs, $10 a month. Total for all of them, $25.95. CourseSmart, one biology textbook, $20.25 a month. And there's quite a difference in the prices that they're charging. But what we all need to know is that educational publishing is the most profitable part of the entire publishing industry, by far. It's not Harry Potter. She's made a lot of money, and that's one book, but that whole sector of the publishing industry is really tiny compared to educational publishing. It's a huge profit leader in the for publishers. Now, how open is an open license? And we'll talk today, there's quite a few of them, With OER, we're primarily, if not fully, occupied with the Creative Commons license. And are you familiar, are all of you familiar with Creative Commons? I won't spend too much time on it. But an important thing to remember is that it's still, it's not the public domain. So Tennyson, you can read, you can adapt, you can change, you can do what you want with Tennyson. But as an academic, if you don't put Tennyson's name on it, you're going to be accused of plagiarism. But legally, you can. You can take Tennyson's work, and if you do it for purposes of fraud, then you're committing a crime. But you can use it any way you want. It's the public domain. Creative Commons license comes with some restrictions. And it was built because it avoids automatic copyright restrictions. Remember before I said in 1963, that's when we agreed that everything is copyrighted? And so if everything's copyrighted, how can you share your stuff? How can you let people know that your material can be used by anybody? And for that, you need to put in a license. And Creative Commons has built this for different countries. It's in many different languages. We just had one in Alberta put into the Cree language. So it's in quite a few different small country languages. And they have the license generator that you go online and you click in what you want and it generates it as a human license. That means you can read it. A legal license, only lawyers can read it. And a machine license, which your computer can read. And it does this automatically for you. And what it does, it means that you've agreed that others can copy or change your material without further permission. You've given that permission. There are author's rights, some freedoms are restricted, and the four ones are attribution, reuse, commercial, and making changes. And here's the engine that you can go to online to put in your license. And here are the different licenses. I'll go through quickly because I think most people know. The two on the left are considered open licenses. And those are the ones that are very highly recommended by the open community. It is attribution. Just put your name or the name of your university on it, and share alike. And share alike just means if somebody else changes it, they have to use the same license. The ones they don't like, but they do have a purpose, are no derivatives. That means you can't change it. And this can be useful, for example, if it's a scholarly article and you don't want people to change it, you want them to use it as is. That does not mean that under your fair dealing rights, you can't take part of it out and put a segment of it into your class. But you can't make derivatives. The big one is if it's translated into another language, that's a derivative work. And you'd have to get permission for the author for that. And non-commercial is if somebody's making money on it, you want a piece of the action. So you put non-commercial. So as if somebody says, I could sell this somewhere, they come to you and you give them permission, they sell it and they give you a piece of the money. But for most teachers, this is a dream. I mean, most of us just do not make any money. There's a very small minority who do make quite a bit of money. But for most of us, most of our material, we don't make much on. I had a best-selling book on learning objects, 376 copies sold to university libraries. I didn't make any money. I might have got £500 out of it or something like that. I mean, our educational books do not generally generate much money. And Loris Lessig, the American lawyer, said, look, we need two versions of copyright. One for Britney Spears. She needs to protect her songs, and that's fine. But in education, this all just gets in the way, and we're best to just forget about it and go to open educational resources. But it's worth remembering, right? It's a privileged monopoly. Whenever anyone says, and we've changed our the intellectual property policy at our university, we're arguing now, no, it won't be. It'll be the privileged monopoly policy, and not use the words that they try to make us squeezes into. And by the way, there's been court cases, I don't know about the UK, but in the United States and Canada, that quite clearly and without any ambiguity, the court says it is not property. Copyright is not property. What it is a copyright. It's a monopoly. And they've tried to change it and make it a copy, but so far the courts have not agreed with them at all. Now, along comes one of the main reasons why we do not want to use commercial property, DRM. Digital rights management. These are the digital locks that they put on your material. And here's some examples where people downloaded Animal Farm from Amazon and then it was taken away from them because it had a digital lock on it and they could go in and take your material away from you. They've done this deliberately. So what you have when you've agreed for this digital lock is it locks your computer and prevents your computer from doing things that you may want it to do. Three common types. Amazon applies its own to ebooks. They completely control the system. When they have their DRM on, they have full control over your computer's operating system. Apple, they apply its Fair Play DRM to all files purchased from the iBook store. And what happened to me, I had a book that I bought from Apple. And I was on a plane and I thought, well, I'll read it on my tablet. And they said, oh, you can't connect to the internet. You can't read this because you're not connected to the internet. And I thought, well, that's ridiculous. Anyway, I landed in Paris, went to my hotel room, opened my book, and it said, you cannot access this book in this country. You paid for the book. This is your book, but they take it away from you. Adobe uses a program called Adobe Content Server to manage their DRM, so it's quite common, digital rights management. But who's really losing? Any obstacle that makes a record harder to listen to is bad news for the artist that made it. And with recordings, they got rid of most DRM quite a while ago because it became ridiculous. I remember very early on, I had a Commodore 64. Anyone here old enough to remember that? Nobody. Anyone will admit that they are old enough? Well, I started off with a Commodore 64 back in 1982. And at that time, they had a word processor called Paperclip. And you had this dongle that you had to put in order for it to work. And you're all the time misplacing the dongle and trying to find it and everything else. So I joined this club computer technology students at McGill University, where I was going. And within about a day, we managed to break it open, and we all got copies of it without the dongle. So there's an example of the pirated version is better than the legal version. And that type of mentality, I mean, it just cannot. How can you keep making money if the pirated version is better than yours? We even have it now. How many have heard of Sci-Hub? There's no pile. Oh, there's a few pirates in the room, so generally nodding their heads. They don't want to admit it, but Sci-Hub is in Kazakhstan. I think it's out of Kazakhstan now. It's somewhere on the web. But if you go to Sci-Hub, you may have to look around a bit because they keep changing the address. And it has a repository of some estimate 70 to 80% of all the world's scientific articles, and they're freely available. But the beauty of it, and I use it, but I don't use it illegally because our university has the right to access that content. You can search it through all of the different companies that control it. Like you go to our library, you've got to go to one database, then switch and go to another database, then switch, go to another database. On this one, it's got them all together, and you can search it and find things a lot easier than you can in the legal ones. And again, legally, under fair dealing, is it fair? We have a license to access, for example, the Journal of Distance Education. It's a Thomson Reuters. We have that license at our university. If I access it through them, I'm still legal. But for many people in developing countries, they don't have that kind of access, and this is a real boon for them. And so, yeah, they're making it harder to listen to, harder to access. I mentioned here the Sony rulebook, where they actually put in their digital rights management. When you downloaded their game, it destroyed your operating system. It was a huge error about, 7 or 8 years ago that they did. Now, with digital rights management, you get your electronic content. You can't do any of these things. Copy, paste, annotate, highlight, text-to-speech, needed for people with visual disabilities. Format changing, you can't change the format from Windows to Apple. You can't even move the material from one Windows device to another Windows device. You can't print out anything. You can't move it geographically. I gave you the example in France. They've divided the world up into regions for their own benefit. And if you go from one region to the other, it won't work. And you can't use it after an expiry date. If it's an electronic textbook, a week or two after the exam, they just take it off and it's gone. And you can't resell it like a printed textbook. You can resell it. When I went to school, you'd buy the textbook in those days, $30, which was a lot of money in those days. And you'd sell it for $15, half price. Now they're $200, and they sell them for $100 and do it, but you cannot do it with these digital content. Their DRM software needs deep permissions in the operating system, and it can stop normal operating system functions. So they're putting these locks onto your device, and they're controlling what's in your device. And do you have this problem of access codes? This is a growing problem in the United States, and it's starting to become a problem in Canada, is they sell you the textbook, but you need to get an access code. The only way you can get the access code is by paying $250 for the textbook. If you don't buy the textbook, then you have to pay $200 for the access code. And you have to have the access code in order to do the tests and to study on the course. And there's a big movement now complaining about this, just how much you're locked in to the publisher's content. And again, we need to get away from that. And OER is the way to do it. And this is the call, really, that our device is our property. I own this. This is mine. They don't own their content. They have a copyright. They have a monopoly over their copyright. And in order to preserve their copyright, they are disabling my device. And they're restricting our freedom. And that's a simple question. Can we not own and control our own property? They're putting handcuffs on our devices, and We're innocent. We haven't done anything wrong. We're innocent. They're just assuming that you'll be bad.
How many have seen this?
The uploader has not made this video available in your country. Do you see that much in England? We do in Canada. Again, stopping us from doing it. But there's ways around it. And this is what the publishers want. A CD that self-destructs after one playing. Well, they actually brought in legislation in the American Congress to so as the publishers could destroy your device if you use what they consider to be pirated content. Luckily, it didn't get anywhere. I mean, it was ridiculous. But nevertheless, that's what they want. Again, what they want is full control over you and what you do. The World of Warcraft. How many are familiar with the problem that just came up with the World of Warcraft, where they put in a whole new version and that you have to pay for, and the old version doesn't work anymore. They blocked it and stopped it. So, complete control over you. Oh, here's the big one, Error 53. How many have seen that one? I hope nobody. How many have heard of it? Well, it's a British reporter who first reported on it. And he was in Kosovo, and his iPhone broke. And there was no Apple dealer in Kosovo. So he went to a computer technology expert, and he fixed it for him, and it worked. And of course, reporters, they absolutely depend on their iPhones now. It's become an essential part of their work. It worked fine. This guy fixed it for him. He came back to England, and the next time there was a notice to upload the latest version of the operating system, you get them about twice a year, he uploaded the latest version of the operating system, and he got this message, Error 53, and it totally disabled his iPhone. He went to the iPhone store, and they said, there's nothing we can do, it's disabled, you have to buy a new one. And so people who think that they're not going to do these things and they're not going to attack us in this way, here's an example of where they actually have done that. And there's been, so far I've heard of about 3 or 4 cases, not many, but it could be more. I mean, for us in Canada, the Apple dealer might be, 600 miles away? It's a big country. We have small towns and no Apple dealer. It's a big problem. Now, I've talked to you about digital rights management and digital locks. Now I want to talk about digital licenses. How many have read the license when you click I agree? The license. How many? Nobody? I'm the only. Oh, good. There's two nerds in the room. Only nerds read those licenses. I've read them. Some of them are 60 to 70 pages long. But what you've agreed to, when you click on that I agree, is this. All of the DRM stuff. Copy and paste, text to speech, format change, the fact that you cannot do them, you've agreed to. You've also agreed that the owners have no liability, even if the product doesn't work. Well, you figure it out. You go to a hardware store and you get a screwdriver and it breaks. What do? You take it back, right? There's a guarantee, there's an implicit guarantee on you buy something, unless you put as is on the bill. There's an implicit guarantee. Well, you've agreed that there is no implicit guarantee. If it doesn't work, tough for you. You've also agreed that owners can invade your computer without your permission. They can come in at any time. They can collect and use your personal data. And the license is not limited to the data using their application. It's any of your data. And you've agreed to that. And by the way, they do use it. They won't do it probably to attack you personally or to do it, but they'll use it in the aggregate. And that you have a privilege to use the product. You don't own it. So you don't own their content that they've downloaded. You think you own it? No, it says you click on it when you buy it, you say buy it, you buy it, but you don't own it. And here's the real problem with this, is you're prohibited to show your content to others. You're not allowed to get your copy of 50 Shades of Grey and show it to somebody else, whether you would or not. But you're not allowed to show it. Now, can you imagine you have a textbook and you have a study group and you can't show it to your teacher, or the teacher can't show their version to another student? But this is part of the license. Not only that, by the way, it's a criminal offense in the United States. And with the transatlantic and trans-Pacific trade agreements, they're trying to make it a criminal offense in other countries. Could you imagine being in jail 10 years from now? What did you do? I showed my book to my wife. You'd be pretty low down on the prison hierarchy. And you must accept that you have no rights. You remember before we were talking about fair dealing, and we have fair dealing rights that must be interpreted liberally. But you've agreed that you don't have any rights. And so what they've done is reinforce legally what they're stopping you from doing technologically. In Google Chrome, they say, we're going to own all of your shit, whether you like it or not. Deal with it. And that's their attitude. They own all of your information. They have a huge amount of information on any one of us. And having that information, the United States government, and we know that the Canadian government and the British government collaborate very closely together. And we worry, we say, oh, we can't have that in the United States. It's the Digital Millennium Copyright Act. And then Julian Assange sends us material showing that we give them all the information they want anyway through our Secret Service. So, open textbooks, open ebooks. You can copy, paste, annotate, highlight, do what you want. Text to speech, you can hyperlink, you can format change, move your material, print it out, move it geographically, there's no expiry date. You can reuse, re-remix it, mash it, and we retain our privacy and digital rights. That's why I believe, with evidence, that open educational resources are essential. They're essential. They're not a nice thing to do, and isn't it wonderful they're free? No, they're essential for e-learning implementations. Here's an extract from a license. Microchip's authorized representatives will have the right to reasonably expect, inspect, announced or unannounced, in its sole and absolute discretion, licensees' premises, your premises, you've agreed to this. They can come into your premises unannounced and to audit licensees' records and inventory of licensees' use of the software. They have every right to know everything you've done with their software, whether located on licensees' premises or elsewhere at any time. Full control. Full control. We don't realize what we're agreeing to. Here's one. Do you own what you pay for? Make sure we read the terms of service. But we're all going to agree to them anyway. Sorry. Access rights. Vendors can control how, when, where, and with what specific brands of technological assistance audiences are able to access their content. They brought a new concept into the world. You buy, but you don't buy. Do you remember the world we used to live in? If you bought something, you owned it? Do you remember that world? This is a new world. It's quite different. It's a totally different concept. Do you remember you could buy a hammer and you could use it to hammer in any kind of nail you wanted? You could use it any way you wanted. You could even hammer somebody. I won't advise you to do it. You can use it any way you want. Well, now we're in a situation where you buy it, but they control how you use it and what you use it for. You know, all this hammer you can only use for these 5-inch nails, and you cannot use it for anything else. I mean, yes, 5-inch, okay, I'm talking too much. Yeah, it's a new world. It's like, I tell you this about my sister, great lady, but she tells me she wants to be buried in a cardboard box. And she thinks it's some big charity thing, or, you know, not paying money to the horrible funeral industry or whatever. But the way I see it, she wants to make her husband and her brother look cheap. It's control beyond the grave. Like, she's not happy controlling us in life, but beyond the grave she's going to control. This is like this. They sell it, and they still control you. Well, okay, we've been through those. So we're in the post-ownership society, as Audrey Waters tells us. We all just share and rent on the powerful platforms of Silicon Valley billionaires. This is far from a satisfactory alternative. David Wiley reminds us that openness is the skeleton key that unlocks every attempt at vendor control and lock-in. When you subscribe to content through a digital service, the publisher achieves complete and perfect control over you and your use of their content. So, how can we participate? There's an OER Chairs Network. If you have graduate students studying OER, I encourage you to encourage them to join the OER Chairs Network. Here's the partners. You could even, I encourage you to apply for a chair in OER. Well, I think Martin Weller in the OU has done that, so you have one, and there he is. And we've got Slovenia, Mexico, Holland, Brazil, New Zealand, and Canada. And I just heard we'll be getting one in South Africa for fairly shortly. So that's the international one. And Fred Mulder, actually this is, the OU is leading this now. It's founded by Fred Mulder, but for the PhD in the study of OER, the Global OER Graduate Network. And so any graduate students studying OER should consider joining this network. They have travel funds to go to the conference and present papers, etc. If you want to know any research about OER, I recommend our initiative, the OER Knowledge Cloud. It now has over 1,200 research articles and reports about OER. So as if a student is studying it or you are doing research, go to this site, and if you find that if you know of an article that isn't on this site on OER, please tell us and we'll put it in there. And here's some examples of material on OER. And the Commonwealth of Learning has quite a few good books on it. MOOCs, I won't go into too detail, we don't have time. There's only one thing you need to remember about MOOCs, and that is they were not invented in the United States. They were invented in Canada. Stephen Downes and George Siemens. I participated with them in the first MOOC, as did many others in Canada. So it's not American. And just to give you an idea of what's happening, if you take a Coursera course, you get a statement of accomplishment. And notice what's written in there is, you may not use it as part of any tuition-based or four-credit certification or program. Well, what's the point? Why do you get a certificate? What, I mean, if you can't use it for anything, why have it? It doesn't make any sense to me. It's a useless certificate. I've never heard anyone with the galls to put something like that together. A certificate that you can't use. Well, if you're not going to use it, you don't want it. Why? Anyway, that's the reality there. And we're saying that a course can be broken down, like a MOOC can be the content. The accreditation can be quite different. And the peer learning and interaction can be different. So a course does not have to be all these three things together. These can be broken down and used differently. And the idea is disaggregation of courses. And that's what we're looking at with the OERU. That's the meeting I'm going to with the University of the Highlands and Islands in Inverness. They're hosting it. 35 institutions around the world are members. And the question is this: learners who access OER and acquire knowledge and skills cannot have their learning assessed and accredited. This is a big problem in Canada, where we have many immigrants, very well-educated immigrants, who cannot get their credentials recognized. We have the most educated taxi drivers in the world. And it's a big problem, but it's a big problem in many countries around the world where they have the skills, but they can't get them assessed. So we're building pathways, and this graph explains it better than any other way. The traditional university model is our students, using our faculty, take our courses, and they get our credential. The OERU model is this: any learners anywhere, not necessarily students, using any faculty anywhere, maybe no faculty, maybe with students working together, using any materials. We expect mainly OER, but any materials. But if they want an Athabasca University credential, they take our assessment. If they want a University of Southern Queensland credential, they take their assessment. If they want the Highlands and Islands credential, they take their assessment. And that's the OERU model. And we can use Challenge for Credit, which we have at our university. And this is basically this. I know second year French. Oh, you do? Well, come here and take our assessment. We assess you, and if you can show that you can pass the exam and the test, whatever assessment is, second year French, we give you the credential. And we've been doing that for many years. And you can do a computerized testing, multiple choice, peer assessment, portfolios we use, projects. There's a number of ways of doing this. And with prior learning assessment, we check people's experience. We do a comprehensive study, but it's a very labor-intensive process and it's very costly. So the opportunity is this: if public institutions do not adapt, then the gap can and will be filled by private for-profit entrepreneurs like the University of Phoenix, the Apollo Group, and others. We need to do it. And we need to ask ourselves, what's wrong with cost-effectiveness? Why is it a problem? If we can teach 1,000 students for $10,000, why are we only teaching 20? That's the difference. Ern Whiteside said, affordability in the future may be the first requirement, not an afterthought. The race may not be to the swift, but to the cheap. And of course, if you're not confused by now, you really don't understand what's going on. There are some people who know exactly what they're doing. Be very careful of them. They're either fools or charlatans. The reason you're confused is because the world is confusing. Remember, everything you know is wrong. Everyday computers are making people easier to use. And innovation always produces hostility among those who prosper in old paradigms. Everything you know is not really wrong, it's changing. And I want to point this out, this is important. The Royal Society is the oldest scientific society in the world, founded in the 17th century. They say the restriction of the commons by patents, copyright, and databases is not in the interest of society and unduly hampers scientific endeavor. And the previous Pope, Benedict, said, on the part of rich countries, there is excessive zeal for protecting knowledge through an unduly rigid assertion of the right to intellectual property. What does this tell us? God. Science and God are on our side. We are on the side of the angels. And I'm going to finish off with this little tale about the frog. Have you heard that story of you put a frog in water? You slowly heat up the water till it boils. And by the time it's boiled, its feet are cooked and it can't jump. And I told this story quite a few years ago because I wanted people to jump. Say, technology's bubbling all around you, jump. So I put it out on the internet and I get an email back and from another country and it said, very sorry, Dr. McGrail, but at 47 degrees Celsius, a knee-jerk reaction in the right anterior something-something of the left something-other causes the frog to automatically eject itself from the water. And I thought, oh my God, there's people around the world putting frogs in water and boiling it because of my story. So I had to put out a disclaimer. I said, there seems to be a cultural misunderstanding. I said, I come from the maritime region of Canada, and there we don't let the facts interfere with a good story. So I'll finish with that, and hopefully we can continue discussing.